Sorry, David here? Oh. What? It's three. We're 3 minutes ahead of schedule, aren't we? What? Oh, it's 5:10. Okay. Well, I can start.
We can give it one more minute and then, you know, we can always come back.
You can come back at the end.
It's been done.
So we start the afternoon program with Leonardo Rastelli from the Young Institute for Theoretical Physics, who will tell us about the superconformal bootstrap.
Okay, thank you very much. It's a pleasure and honor to be here. If David comes back, I will wish him happy birthday later. If not, I won't. I've been asked to give an overview of the conformal bootstrap, which I'm very happy to do, as a subject dear to my heart. It's, of course, a rather large subject by now, so I will, as is customary in this case, is chart a personal path to this large field. Also, I have 1.5 hours, obviously, of course, I can fill it rather easily. I prepare an enormous amount of material, but I don't want also to, conquer this audience into submission. So if you have questions, please slow me down, and I don't need to really need to cover all the hundreds of slides that I have. I suppose I can be rather short for this audience. I don't need to convince you why the conformal field theory is a fundamental subject. Conformal field theories govern the long distance dynamics of any generic quantum field theory. And in fact, David, I think, raised an objection at the beginning of Nati's talk the other day that as particle physicists, we're not just interested in the extreme infrared, and that's of course true, but I am one sort of step up the food chain with respect to Nati. I'm not just interested in the extreme infrared topological degrees of freedom, I also want to keep the interesting massless mode dynamics in the case that there is some. And in fact, conformal field theories very generally under certain assumption I could spell out more precisely, but that would be the subject of a separate talk, are believed to be signposts in the space of quantum field theories. And so the conjectural behavior is that in reasonably behaved unitary quantum field theories, you flow from some conformal field theory in the UV to some other possibly trivial, if the theory is gapped, or possibly free, in many other cases, conformal field theory in the IR. And generically, the conformal field theory in the IR will be non-trivial and interacting. The striking experimental fact that, of course, has been known for decades is that you can start from several different looking, or actually generally different, UV starting points, and you flow to the same basin of attraction. Of course, Wilson gave us a beautiful physical picture for this in terms of denormalization group, but that does explain why you lose information and why there are different bases of attraction, but I think it's fair to say that it doesn't quite explain why things are so universal. So we really find experimentally that critical exponents really depend on extremely crude properties of the system, such as dimensionality and the symmetries of the order parameter. It could have happened, for all we know, that there could be a handful of different infrared peak fixed points with the same symmetries and the same number of error operators, but that really does not seem to happen in most cases, and it's not simply explained just by this RG picture. And the main theme of this talk, in fact, is that this will happen because the infrared fixed points is so constrained that we will find a unique possible theory with those symmetries. And here I've listed the canonical physical applications of conformal field theory. I already mentioned phase transition. There are quantum critical points, some more speculative particle physics application, which, however, is important to mention because historically has been the one that has motivated the technical innovations that have led to recent progress in the conformal bootstrap. And of course, again, to this audience, I need to belabor the point, by the SFT, quantum gravity and asymptotically anticipated space-time is governed by CFT. So the Bravais framework is one that will be very familiar to many of you. Despite the name, we are not going to think of conformal field theory as a theory of fields, the kind of semi-classical fields you write down in Lagrangian and integrate over in a path integral, but we want to think more abstractly. So a conformal field theory will be defined by the algebra of its local operators, at least for now, and the theory will be defined by specifying the complete set of correlation functions of this local operator. And the crucial point is that this is an algebra. There is a operator equation, which is a true operator equation. This is an absolutely convergent sum when we plug this into a correlation function, and the convergent is, the radius of convergence is governed by the distance to the nearest other insertion. And so unlike many other sums that we encounter in quantum field theory, this is absolutely convergent, and so true equation that is not an asymptotic expansion. So here I have a first caveat. I've insisted so far in characterizing the theory by the set of local operators where x is a space-time point. But of course, there are other interesting observables in the theory, notably conformal defects, such as Wilson lines in a conformal gauge theory, or boundaries, or interfaces, or surface defects. And it will be eventually important to enlarge a framework to incorporate those, but I will have very little to say about those in this talk. Perhaps if you want, you can ask me questions at the end. So, as familiar, we can now proceed to compute a generic endpoint function by successive application of this operator product. And eventually, we reach the point where we have one single operator, which evaluates to zero, except for the identity, which evaluates to one. And so, clearly, if we know these coefficient functions, or to be more precise, if we know the quantum number of all the local operators, which are here specified by giving the conformal dimension, some set of Lorentz quantum numbers, and possibly some additional quantum numbers under flavored symmetries, and if I know the structure constants, these so-called conformal data, by taking successive application of P, are enough to determine all correlators, hence to completely specify the theory. Well, I have a second caveat here that I'm going to mention now. So here, I told you that the expectation value of a single operator is zero. Well, that's only true if we work in flat d-dimensional Euclidean space on a more interesting geometry. The one-point function need not be zero, or it need not be zero in the presence of conformal defects or boundaries. And so when this one-point function is not zero, we are going to get additional, a more intricate story, which plays a fundamental role in two dimensions. It leads to the constraint of modularity. But this will be ignored, again, in the bulk of my talk. If you want, I can come back to it at the end. And so modulo this caveat, the question is, what kind of constraints are imposed on the CFT data just by the operator product expansion in flat space? And the fundamental constraint is the one of associativity. Clearly, as I evaluate this endpoint function, I must get the same result no matter how I fuse the operators, which means that the operator product taking first with 1 and 2 and then 3, or 2 and 3 and then 1, must give the same result. That's associativity. And the kind of theories we will mostly consider today, we will also impose that the theory is unitary in Lorentzian signature or equivalently reflection positive in the Euclidean signature. And this translates into certain lower bounds on the dimension for given quantum numbers, and it also translates into the fact that you are allowed to choose a real basis of operators for which the structure constants are real. As I was saying, in more non-trivial geometry, there may be other conditions that arise from a non-zero one-point function. Notably, in two dimensions, we have the constraint of modular invariance. that are very strong, but if you think about it for a minute, it's very unclear what kind of constraint modularity could impose into them in dimensions higher than two on the local operator spectrum, because in radial quantization, well, there's no simple transformation you can do that would map two different slices of the Hilbert space having the same type of states as is the case in the torus in two dimensions. No, here?
Yes.
Yes, you can play various games, but there will never be such a simple condition as you have in two dimensions. And I say that to this day, this is a very open problem to characterize a constraint of modular invariance in a dimension. But I think one thing that seems to be clear is that you're never going to get a set of closed conditions just for the local operators. You will have to relay local operator with other kinds of quantization of the space, possibly involving higher dimensional defects. So that gets us to the bootstrap program, which was articulated by Polyakov in a prescient and essentially incomprehensible paper in the beginning of the 1970s, which, however, with modern hindsight, we can now try to really decipher. And so it's this equation, it's a condition of associativity on this data. So this translates the problem of finding and solving the conformal field theory into an eminently algebraic problem. So this is not that different at face value. Of course, it's a lot more complicated, but structurally, it's not that different from the problem that Dinkin solved when he classified simple Lie algebras. You have a set of algebraic conditions. It's an infinite dimensional problem, but you can hope to make progress by taking some kind of answer in some simple cases, etc. And now we get a new perspective on this striking critical universality we observe in nature. Perhaps the reason that we find that critical exponents are really determined just by the extremely crude features of the system, such as dimensionality and symmetry of the other parameter, is because, after all, there could be just one solution of this continuous condition with those symmetries and with that specified number of relevant operators. The number of relevant operators entered here because it characterizes the dimensionality of the phase diagram. So the dimensionality of the critical surface, the phase diagram is parameterized by the number of relevant operators, and so we can now go ahead and ask the question, how many conformal field theories with, say, Z2 symmetries are there in two dimensions that have one Z2 even and one Z2 odd operator? And if the answer turns out to be one, that explains critical universality in the end. With supersymmetry, obviously not true, but it's not true by a tiny amount in some sense, because here you have an infinite set of constraints, an infinite amount of data. What presumably you're alluding to is the existence of manifolds of coupling constants, which of course are still finite dimensional. I'll come back to that question. Well, yeah, they may have the same relevant operators, but their low line spectra still look different. So yes. It does arise as a sense symmetry, although if you look at the lattice gas picture, you can conceptualize it rather easily.
In that way of I
would say that there are many more equations than variables, but that's just that's just my.
Is there some way of making that
very naively, yes. You just think how things grow with the number of open. Of course, it's the continuous field theory equation. So, as you all know, the problem has been brilliantly solved for theories where this algebra in two dimensions, given the power of the fact that the conformal group is infinite dimensional because it's a group of holomorphic reparametrizations. Then you can be so lucky that, in fact, you can solve this type of associativity condition with a finite number of representations of this infinite dimensional group, and then that's basically the definition of what it means to the theory to be rational. You may have some enlarged symmetry group, which is not just a conformal group. There will be additional chiral symmetries. But anyway, by definition, rational SFT is one where this type of conditions reduce to a finite dimensional problem, and then it's not that surprising that you can solve it. It's still very striking, of course, and leads to very beautiful results. Till rather recently, there was not much known about the higher dimensional case, and that's where our story really starts. Okay, so even in 2D, as I surely emphasize, for theories that are not rational, not much is known. Now, there are theories such as Liouville theory, which are almost rational, or can be treated in a very similar way to rational SFTs, but beyond the rational case, even in 2D SFT, it's pretty much an open problem. So again, I can be brief here because surely you have seen this before. We want to use the symmetry of the problem as much as we can, so we organize the operators into representation of the conformal group. Representation of the higher dimensional conformal groups are extremely simple. There is a lowest weight state. I had some slides that I decided to cut because I didn't want to insult anybody. There's a state operator map in conformal field theory that I'm taking for granted. And so you start from the lowest operator, also known as lowest state by the state operator map, and you add with raising operators, which are given by momenta or derivatives of the operator, and on the other hand, you go down with special conformal generators K, and so the generic representation of the conformal group just looks like this. You add freely with derivatives. In some easily identifiable special cases, there may be null states that you must mod out by. Typical examples are conserved currents. If you have, say, an object of spin 1 as the primary, whose divergence is 0, that is another way of saying that the contraction of p mu with the operator is null, and that you must mod out by it, so that this reduced representation is especially shorter, and this, in fact, is possible if and only if the dimension obeys a certain shortening condition, which in this case is equal to the dimension of space-time minus 1. But except for some very easily identifiable special cases such as conserved currents and free fields, representations of the higher dimensional conformal group are all of this type. So so we can use the symmetry to further organize the operator product expansion in terms of a sum over primaries and their descendants. So here in this expression, I'm only summing over primaries O, and the contribution of descendants, which are just derivatives, is accomplished by this function B, which is purely determined from the kinematics of the conformal group. And so the only non-trivial information is contained in the structural constants of the three primaries. So if we do a double OP in the four-point function, we insert the OP twice. We use the fact that we can always choose a basis of operators such that, first of all, primary operators with different dimension are orthogonal. If they have the same dimension, we can choose a basis where they are orthogonal. And so that leads a double sum to a single sum, and we get the square of the OB coefficients, and we resum these coefficient functions into a special function called the conformal block. And here, I've further taken another step. I've used the familiar fact that if you have 4 points, you can choose a conformal frame where 1 point is where you can fit 3 points. And a particular useful conformal frame is the one where you take 1 point to 1 point to 0, I'm sorry, 1 point to 1 point to infinity. And the fourth operator, let's say x2, is then constrained to live in a plane, which we parameterize with complex coordinate z, and is complex conjugate z bar. In terms of the original variables, sometimes one introduces this conformal cross-sections u and v, which take this explicit form, and this particular variable z, as I've defined it, is given explicitly in this way. So here, of course, I've used conformal covariance to argue that this conformal block is just a function of the two cross ratios. Now, I don't want to belabor too much on the theory of conformal blocks, so I will have some comments later. So at the moment, suffice it to say that they are completely determinable in principle from the kinematics of the conformal group. In fact, they are explicit hypergeometric functions in even space-time dimensions, and in odd space-time dimensions, one can find rather easily the recursion relations, which for our numerical purpose are really good enough. So, so we can now use this representation. Yes? Right. So, not that we know of. So, in two dimensions, the conformal blocks that I'm talking about, the analog in two dimensions, the object I'm talking about would be the block for the global part of the conformal block, which would be the SL2, SL2C. So, in two dimensions, you have much more because you have at least Virasoro symmetry. And in some cases, as you're saying, you may have even more than Virasoro. You have Katsumudi symmetry or W symmetry. And then you have much bigger blocks, which each of which would be an infinite sum of the SL2 blocks. But in higher dimension, you don't have the luxury. You don't have an infinite dimensional symmetry. And so these blocks are just taken care of the representation theory of the finite dimensional. Sorry? Well, we will see that there is an interesting story in supersymmetric theories where some of the good features of the two-dimensional story will reemerge, but at the moment, no. At the moment, we just have this finite dimensional conformal algebra. And so here I've rewritten the associativity condition that I had earlier. So I can either fuse 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, or alternatively 1 and 4 and 2 and 3. And that just amounts at the permutation of the space-time labels, which exchanges the cross ratios U and V. And also because of the prefactor that I had in front, that to absorb the explicit scaling delta phi, if you work it out, you will see that also you will need it's a very simple algebra, these additional factors of U and V here. And so this is the condition of associativity for this in this ultra simple case of the 4-point function of identical scalars. The fact that I'm looking at the 4-point function of 4 identical external operators, which are scalar, is important here, because obviously the sum in both channels is the same. All that changes are the labels of the space-time labels, but the quantum numbers of the operator exchange are the same because there's no difference in the quantum numbers of the 4 identical operators. So, so this is just an example. In fact, the absolutely simplest example, which is what the one that has motivated 95% of the numerical work has been done in this business. But of course, so here I'm looking at the tiny set of the possible constraints. So Shiraz wanted me earlier to enumerate a number of constraints. Well, this is clearly enough. It's an infinite set of constraints for an infinite amount of variables. It's an infinite set of constraints because you get one constraint for each value of U and V. And it's also clear that I have an infinite number of variables because I have infinitely many operators I can exchange. And so the unknowns in this equation are the quantum numbers of the operator, which are a priori, that are exchanged, which I a priori don't know, and this OP coefficient, which also a priori I don't know. But it should be clear, of course, that I should be able well, it's not that I should be able. I'm really instructed to repeat this, to repeat exactly the same analysis when I take any, on the external legs, any possible operator, and then I would have to impose a complete set of constraints. So it's, in fact, in my mind, still somewhat of a mystery that we can get so far just by analyzing this ultra simple constraint. So I will come back to this point later. So as I said, this is the story for scalar, for identical scalar operators, but of course there is a lot of industry in generalizing this to more general ephemeral operators, and that will. No, the conformal block is just derived from conformal kinematics. So I'll comment about this a little bit later. It's in the conformal blocks. In the conformal blocks. So let me just say it because so otherwise. So the most invariant characterization of this object, these are eigenfunctions obeying appropriate boundary condition of the Casimir operator of the conformal group, which is SOD plus 1, comma 1 for the Euclidean group. And so that's where D comes in, because these are appropriate, if you want, appropriate spherical harmonics for the conformal group that certainly know about the dimensional space-time. Absolutely.
This was the bootstrap Mandelstam program with the Sienna kind of solution for. And then, unlike an irrespective solution, which was then in which the further constraints of all the other components and disentangled the original.
Right.
It's slightly different, though.
It's exactly.
Right. So,
to be sure, so just look at that.
Yes, so. Right, so.
There was no string theory. This was constructing a quasi symmetric S matrix theory via poles in either channel.
The reason works in string theory in the end is precisely this thing in the underlying quasi-symmetric, as you know very well. Of course, as you explained.
Of course. And,
I want to make a small comment about this. So,
I actually wanted to connect that to a question. So, in string theory, in order to actually figure out what you have in that solution, you had the problem of degeneracy. So, in other words, you had a pole, but that pole had an e to the m degeneracy, which you could only figure out by solving the complete set of.
Right. So the advantage of not having been alive in the 60s is that we get to repeat the same mistakes. So of course all of this was came to mind to many of us, and so we tried, of course, very similar approaches to. There is, for example, an open question, which is sort of an obvious one. Can you bootstrap the S matrix for globals in large N QCD? So we know that in large N, the S matrix is saturated by single poles. It looks simple because you don't have to deal with this cut structure. And so it's an ancient dream. Can you just compute from first principle the spectrum of globals in large N QCD? And of course, it's pretty much hopeless. But perhaps there will be a way eventually. I can mention one thing, that there is a more precise technical connection between this bootstrap equation and the if you will old-fashioned S matrix bootstrap equation, which is given by the Mellin representation of conformal field theory correlators. So if you make a Mellin transform, you can convert these U and V to variables which very much behave like S and T of Mandelstam. And in fact, there was a nice observation in a paper by Mack that spurred a lot of work. And well, perhaps I'll come back to it at the end. Okay, so now we have this sum rule. In principle, we really have an infinite set of sum rules. And how do we analyze them? Well, in the second half of my talk, I will tell you how to analyze them in the supersymmetric case, where you have further analytic niceness. But in the generic non-supersymmetric case, you can roughly do either one of two things. There is a semi-analytic approach that works in a specific kinematic limit of these variables. which I'm going to describe in the next slide, and that gives some nice analytical, partial analytical control on certain asymptotics of the spectrum. And then there is a numerical approach that doesn't require to focus on a certain part of the spectrum, but of course it's numeric. Nevertheless, it's very powerful, and that's where I will focus mostly. And the idea of the numerical approach is to truncate the set of constraints. It's very important. We are not truncating the theory. So we are not taking this theory with infinitely many operators and decide to focus on a subset of the theory and try to close the equation in that subset, because that will introduce an error. We're keeping the complete theory with the complete set of operators, but we're just looking at a smaller finite dimensional set of constraints. So whatever you get may not be optimal because you have decided to look at a smaller set of the constraints, but it's not an approximation. It's exact in that sense. It's a rigorous result. So, let me describe briefly this story of the large spin asymptotics. This was work that was already in some sense implicit in a paper by Alain Malassène, and then was worked out in great detail by Zohar Jiboyedov and by this other group. And in fact, a preliminary observation I should have made, which connects actually to your question. You can instantly see that the only way you can satisfy the sum rule is with an infinite number of primaries. And the reason for it is that if you look at an individual block and you ask what are the asymptotics of the block in the cross channel, it simply has the wrong asymptotics to be matched with the OPE in the cross channel. And so it's clear that no finite number of blocks will ever produce the correct asymptotics in the cross channel. This is to be contrasted with the story that you're familiar with in two dimensions, where if you look at, for example, the minimal models, well, clear enough, there you have summing over a finite number of blocks, so it's better be that each of them has the correct asymptotics in the cross channel. Of course. That's what I meant. So for the Virasoro blocks, of course, we get away because it's an infinite dimensional globe. For the SL2 blocks, it's exactly the same story. And so you can. So this extremely rough analysis already tells you need an infinite number of blocks. And if you proceed a step further and you look precisely at what kind of singularity in the cross channel, what kind of accumulation of logarithms in the cross channel will reproduce the correct singularity, you can derive this stronger result. The stronger result is that just from the existence of the identity singularity in one channel, you can predict the existence of an infinite tower of, let me use quote-unquote double trace operator. So if I look at the simple case again of a four-point function of four identical scalar, you can think that there will be in the theory necessarily a tower of operator for each integer n. The operator will have dimension 2 times the dimension of the external operator plus 2n, plus the spin for large spin. So asymptotically for large spin, you must have these infinite towers of operators just to reproduce the correct asymptotics that come from the identity operator in the direct channel. And if you then look at the next correction, which typically will be given by the stress tensor, or more generally will be given by the operator of lowest twist appearing in the direct channel of P of phi with phi, that actually allows you to estimate the leading large spin correction to this dimension. And this was work of Zohar and collaborators.
Is this the first term in a systematic expansion?
And this is absolutely. This is the first term in systematic expansion. There's some recent work by Alain Jiboyedov that attempts to make this systematic.
And the systematic expansion is in twists of operators in the first term.
That's right. So that's right.
I mean, you know, we weren't particularly interested in the or anything like it, but I wanted to prove that European scaling requires a certain amount of distribution. And I proved except for now being that in any other if you assume you are things for, given that you need to change the dimension to protect it, that meant that all the anomalous dimensions would have vanished, and yet, and this allows you to prove that that meant that there would be a fixed point to see how to be zero, how to be a feature.
Thank you. So, so you see there's a lot of structure that we can derive from this sum rule, and so of course you can iterate this. Now you have derived the existence of this tower operator, so you can take them to be in the external legs and derive either towers for each of them. And so it's clear that there's a lot of constraints on the spectrum we could that are just demanded by the sum rule.
And so this is just telling you about these double trace type operators. Is there any way of getting information about more general operators?
Well, you can certainly multi-trace type of operators by iterating this, and four-point functions are enough. For you see, the point is that we're not assuming large n, right? So
four-point functions not what I would have thought of it. Double trace.
Right, but of course, double trace is a misnomer because. Right. That's right. So that was the picture. That was the picture that Aldai and Maldacena had on the dual side. That precisely gives you this type of this term is interpreted holographically as a due to the gravitational interaction holder.
Well, going to large end theory for a moment, this method is not going to give you any information about single trace exchange.
This method. No, it will not give you information about single trace exchange. Okay, so let me get to the second way to analyze the equation. And there will be a third way when we get to supersymmetry. So the second way is to, I've massaged the sum rule slightly. I've separated out the term that comes from the identity, which we all know it is always going to be there. And I've rather than writing S channel equal to T channel, I've written S channel minus the channel equal to zero, and so this is the block minus the cross block, and then this P are the OP coefficient square, and here I've also given you some of the unitarity bounds that you'd encounter in, say, four dimension, to be concrete. So one of the crucial points of recent progress has been modesty. So rather than attempting to solve this analytically, which of course must have been what Polyakov and others were trying to do in the 70s, motivated by a very concrete question in particle phenomenology, this gentleman, Ratazzi Cetoninvicki, asked a more modern question, which was, well, let's try what kind of constraints would this equation give on the space of putative theories. So in some sense, that's a more modern question, because you have to be a little bit accustomed or resigned to the idea that there's a landscape of theories. And so perhaps you have to, you know, try to dry the swamp and eliminate the swampland and try to be on the dry spots of this landscape. And so this idea of theory space is perhaps also a more modern twist that was necessary to get into this kind of progress. And then, of course, personal computers, because every idiot can in 5 minutes can install Mathematica to at least do this a low order in a numerical analysis. So what's the idea? Well, you come up with a certain guess for the. So the idea is that not anything goes. So if you think that you found your favorite theory of the world and you have a certain spectrum that you think the theory should have, I can try to see whether your favorite theory is compatible with this equation. And one canonical type of things I can try to rule out is suppose you have a spectrum that obeys a set of inequalities. Suppose that you think that operators of spin L are greater or equal than some minimum value delta bar of L for any L. Suppose I succeed succeed in finding a linear functional which acts on the space of two variable functions, which is constructed to be positive on all the conformal blocks that obey your spectral assumption. Remember that these are completely non-functions. They may be complicated, but they're completely known once you give me delta and L. So I can just check that my linear function is positive on the set of functions that obey your spectral assumption. It's also positive on the identity. Then I've proven you wrong. Your theory cannot exist because I apply the linear function here. I get something strictly positive equal to zero. That's a contradiction. And on the other hand, if I do not find such a function, perhaps because I haven't explored the complete set of constraints in sufficient exhaustiveness, then I have nothing to tell you. So it's the way Slava likes to think about it, it's an oracle. The oracle says no if it manages to find a contradiction, or it says maybe if it hasn't quite been able to show you wrong. And this is the kind of thing that you can precisely ask a computer to deal with very well. And so this is a more geometric way to think about this. The idea is that you have an infinite space of functions, of two variable functions, which are these conformal blocks, and you're summing them with positive coefficients. So that's the crucial thing, of course. It's a positivity, the coefficient comes from unitarity, and so this set of functions spans a cone, and according to your spectral assumption, it might be the case that your cone is simply too narrow to sum up to the identity vector, which is a fixed vector, or perhaps it's wide enough to include it, and there will be a limited case that will be a bound, will give you a bound on the kind of dimension you're looking at. So
why were you restricting to the intermediate guiding of this scalar?
No, I wasn't.
So this has to work for
some rule very much includes every possible spin. In fact, well, for identical scalar, we are, first of all, the only representation will appear will be symmetric tensors. It's just group theory. In fact, by Bose symmetry, the spin will be even. But other than those trivial conditions, you really sum over everything.
Okay, so this x delta L has to be true for all.
For all. Okay, great. So you may have seen this famous plot. This incredible stroke of luck, or perhaps it was foreordained since time immemorial, but you know, this gentleman found it. They did this exercise in three dimensions, and under the only assumption they are looking at three-dimensional conformal field theory with Z2 symmetry, where you have a scalar which is called sigma, which is Z2 odd, and another scalar epsilon, which is Z2 even, you find this plot. So the oracle says that so long as you are in this shaded region, perhaps there is a theory, and up here there definitely is not a theory. And the first striking fact is that there is a sharp boundary. So you do this numerically, obviously, and eventually you convince yourself that as you explore a larger and larger space of constraints, this converges rather rapidly to some definite limiting curve. And then this plot seems to have a sharp fissure, and you look at the numbers at the fissure, and they're with great approximation agreeing with what we know about the critical exponents of the three-dimensional going from a variety of other methods, from the epsilon sponge to Monte Carlo, etc. So that's a real surprise. And what becomes a striking and beautiful result is the second plot, due to Koss, Poland, Simon, Zaffin, which is a slight refinement of the previous one, where you don't just look at a single correlator, but you look at the set of constraints that come from three correlators, all odd, all even, two odd, and two even. And then now the positivity constraints are slightly more involved, because you have to look at semi-positivity of a matrix. But anyway, you can imagine that there will be a positivity constraint in the system of correlators. And here you make one extra assumption. You input the dimensionality of the phase diagram of the three-dimensional Ising model. You need that, in order to tune yourself to the critical point, you need to tell me the temperature and the magnetic field. One relevant Z2 even scalar and one relevant Z2 odd scalar. So you input that, you require that the other operators are dimension greater than 3, and then you find, well, there's a disconnected region far out here that who cares, but then there's a tiny island just around the three-dimensional Ising model. And this is the result from David last year. This is more precise than Monte Carlo, and it's rigorous. With Monte Carlo, you never know exactly what you're doing. I want to emphasize, this is not the optimal bound, because we aren't done inputting all the constraints, but whatever bound we have found is a mathematical theorem. There are no conformal field theories that live with this symmetry that live outside this tiny region. And so that explains critical universality. We couldn't end up anywhere else because there was no other theory to end up. There is a whole other region, but the other region is really quite far. And so if you have measured the critical exponent with, say, one decimal digit, you know that it couldn't be that you measure the second digit would be different from anything. Yeah, so here, of course, there is a serious question. Is this going to keep shrinking to zero or not? And it does look it's going to keep shrinking to zero, or perhaps it will disappear, in which case you have proven that the three-dimensional Ising model is not conformal. That would be a very surprising.
With just these constraints?
With these constraints.
Epsilon sigma.
Yes.
So you think that these constraints will be enough to narrow down to?
It's just a conjecture at this stage.
But this is numerical.
Sorry?
You got a higher and higher length.
Yeah.
There's a numerical idea.
Well, I mean, eventually, once we have developed more tools, there will be a proof that this infinite set of functional equations have a unique solution. The truncation is arbitrary, but I want to emphasize again that, that's right. So if you take a slightly different truncation, you're going to find a slightly different island. But both would be rigorous results.
Leonardo,
yes?
If you go two slides back to the semi-linear this block, you mentioned that there are many constraints that go into these two lines. But presumably there are two critical constraints, which are exactly the ones between the one line and the second line.
Sorry. Many constraints go into line?
I thought you said that these two lines are a result of a collection of many constraints.
Well, they are collection of many constraints in the sense that I haven't really explained how this is done, but you have infinitely many constraints because this has to be true for every value of u and v.
Yeah.
And so the way in practice this is done, you put yourself the crossing symmetric point and you take derivatives around the crossing symmetric point, and this gives it a system of inequalities. And the larger the system you take, the stronger the constraints you get. Well, at the boundary, all inequalities are equalities. So, but in fact, there is something that I need to sort of. It takes a little bit of geometric thinking, but it's clear the moment you start thinking a bit. At the boundary, the bootstrap equations actually have a unique solution. So if I sit precisely, not necessarily at this corner point, any point on the boundary, then there's a unique set of dimensions, not just the ones that I'm showing here, all the higher ones as well, and OP coefficients are completely determined. So at the boundary, generically, in the generic case, the solution is unique. And that's basically because you have to think again of looking at the living at the boundary of this cone. It just becomes a linear algebra problem of satisfying all the equalities, and there is a unique, generically, unless
kind of no phase-based expression.
Yeah, something like that.
Is there an intuition why the difference between the dimensions is so much smaller than
the sum? The difference between the dimensions. Oh, no, I don't have any intuition. But. Oh, free field theory. So free field theory is here, 0.5, the unitarity bound. So it's down there. That's, of course, allowed. But, of course, that would not satisfy the constraints that we have, additional constraints we impose, that there is a single relevant odd scale. Okay. So let me move on. I promised that I was going to mention a bit about, so this is sort of technical boring stuff, but let me mention a little bit. So obviously, you need to develop a general theory of these special functions. That's basically just representation theory, but technically it's quite hard. So one tool that has proved useful, if you have external tensors or spinners, well, first of all, you have proliferation of tensorial structures. You have to deal with it. And then it's possible to attain the generic block in that case by applying a certain differential operator of a bunch of so-called seed blocks. Now, in three dimensions, the program has, in principle, been completed, although still a lot of work to organize it and implement it in full generality, because there are only two seed functions, four external scalars and two spinors, and two Majorana spinors and two scalars are enough, in principle, by this technique of differential operator to give you the complete set of blocks. Obviously, the higher the dimension, the more intricate the Lorentz representations become. So, for example, in four dimensions, you start having anti-symmetric tensors. So in four dimensions, the story is very much not done. And in particular, the one four-point function we really like to study, obviously, is the four-point function of the stress tensor, because that's a universal object in conformal field theory. That, just the number of tensorial structures is 22. And there's a gazillion of different possible blocks with different internal quantum numbers. And so that is still some work there. And then you have to put it on a computer. So eventually. Now, I don't want to turn this into a laundry list of plots. But there are sort of two, so a lot of work has been done. There are two sorts of results. As I was emphasizing, you can, in some cases, impose, well, in all cases, you can impose rigorous inequalities which carve out the space of CAT data. And then, were you so lucky that your favorite model lies at a special feature of the plots, either because it's a kink of the plot, or because, even better, you do a multicorrelator analysis and it's an island, then you can do a precision study of a specific model. And then, in fact, you can also determine the higher spectrum because there's a unique solution of the sum rule. So these are some of the highlights, three-dimensional N models, five-dimensional N models, three-dimensional fermions. I only want to flash this result because I find it intriguing, something we didn't a priori know and that the Boostrom is trying to tell us. So these are the exclusion plots derived by this gentleman, Iliescu, Kospol, and Pupusimus, and Jacobi, from the four-point function of four Majorana fermions in three dimensions. And the notation is psi is a fermion, sigma is a parity odd scalar, and epsilon is a parity even scalar, and these are the exclusion plots. And you find that there is an interesting fissure here, which perhaps is trying to tell you that there is a theory that lives there. And the interesting coincidence is that there is a fissure both in the exclusion plot of delta psi for delta sigma, which is a parity even, and in the exclusion plot of delta sigma for delta, sorry, this is delta sigma and this is delta epsilon. It's a bit hard to read. This is the parity odd and this is the parity even. At the same value of the external dimension for the spinor, there is a sharp fissure. And you see, the interesting point is that here, this becomes rapidly very vertical, which means that 3 is the threshold for the scalar being relevant. So that means that there's no relevant scalar to the right of this point with parity odd. And here, if you look at the dimension of the scalar for parity even, it's also very high. It's bigger than 5. So if this fissure really signals the presence of the theory, it would be a nice discovery. It would be a dead-end CFT, a CFT which has absolutely no relevant operators, which is a curious thing. Stable. And in fact, sorry? Stable. It's a completely stable, it's a completely stable phase of matter. So it's actually a good open question. It's one of the, it's the kind of structural questions that you may not have asked. So the Boostrom is also a sort of an excuse to try to rethink about quantum field theory in a more structural way. And this is one of those classic structural questions. I guess so. For more. But is that really the same thing? I mean, Yeah, yeah. In two dimensions, of course, there's a Leech, there's a Mostyn theory. In higher dimension, I'm not aware of a single example.
There are kind of theories that still have a Yamaha.
Yes, they are a little controversial, but yes. Of course, if you impose selection rules on global symmetry, you can easily do it. If you say that you don't want to break a certain symmetry, then it's easy to do, but without any assumption. So anyway, it's an interesting question. Do these theories exist? And if they exist, why don't we find materials that exhibit them? Why aren't we all ended up already in this dead end? Yes, there is, and in fact, there is an attempt that I think hasn't quite succeeded to corner the Gross-Neve model by these methods.
Wait, so this funny kink exists even
large? I don't have an answer to that question. I have to look back at the literature.
But if it exists at large, then we can find the tangent, right?
I don't want to say anything silly. Okay. Yes, I'm sure people have looked. Okay, so let me now switch. So that was just an example of the kind of things that you can find. Let me now switch gears and move to supersymmetric theories. So a lot of the discussion is sort of a boring repetition. You had conformal weighted entities, and you have superconformal weighted entities. You had conformal blocks, and you have superconformal blocks. Representation theory of the superconformal algebra is rather intricate, so this becomes quite complicated because you have to deal with a zoo of different types of shortening condition, etc. There's no generic theory of this yet. But okay, so I don't want to focus on the boring part. I want to focus on the interesting part, which is that, as you may have expected, now that you have the power of supersymmetry, there's one true novelty, and the true novelty that you're going to be able to find solvable subsectors. And the question, yeah.
In the previous thing, the two operators we talked about, one was the mass operator, and the second was the stress tensor.
No. Sigma and epsilon are scalar operators.
Can I think of this roughly, one of them roughly as psi bar psi?
Well, psi is a Majorana fermion, yes. So both of them.
And the other one is that.
This is parity even and parity odd.
Are they both scalars?
Absolutely. But of course, in anywhere close to a free theory, this would have a small dimension. I mean, this is just a hint. We don't know. I mean, first of all, as I was saying, if I tune myself at this point, I can, in principle, solve the Boussap equation, at least for this correlator, completely and give you a spectrum. But there's no guarantee that this spectrum will be compatible with the infinite set of constraints that we have not analyzed. But since this game has succeeded before, in the case of the Ising model, one feels somewhat entitled to draw conclusions from this simple-minded plot. Okay, so the story here will be that for extended supersymmetric theories in four dimensions, and also for the very interesting case of 2,0 in six dimensions, we will be able to find a sector of the theory which is completely solvable. In fact, luckily enough, is something we can recognize as just a two-dimensional, the holomorphic set of a two-dimensional CFT, a 2D chiral algebra. There's also a cute story with n equal to 4 supersymmetry in 3D, which I will not talk about today. One finds a non-commutative deformation of the algebra functions on the appropriate Coulomb or Higgs moduli space. That's a recent paper where we put out a month ago. But my focus will be on this more interesting case where we have a chiral algebra. And so how does this work? You pick a plane. The plane is picked as you like. It doesn't matter. And you parameterize by Z and Z bar. And then the assertion that I'm going to justify in a minute. And there's a specific subset of operators of the theory that are inserted on this plane. So I don't allow them to go out of the plane. There's nothing sitting on the plane. I just decide to consider a correlator of operators inserting on this plane, which, although a priori would depend generically on Z and Z bar, are in fact holomorphic, meromorphic functions of Z only. And the rationale for this is something I've seen before in supersymmetry. We define this subset by passing to the cohomology of a certain nilpotent operator, and the perhaps slight novelty here is that rather than looking at a standard Poincaré supersymmetry operator. I'm looking at something more intricate, which is a sum of Q and S. And it turns out that the Z-bar dependence is exact, and so I can integrate Q by parts, and when I take a Z-bar derivative, that does nothing, or in other terms, in cohomology, these operators are only functions of Z. And similar story, n equal 1 curling in 4 dimensions, that's a stronger story because there it's completely independent of position. So what are the operators that obey this condition? Well, at the origin, so now you see I have to distinguish between the operators inserted at the origin and operators inserted elsewhere, because my superchart does not commute with translations because it contains an S. But at the origin, the operators that obey this condition are operators that obey some sort of shortening condition. Delta is the dimension, L is the spin in the plane, and R is some component of the R symmetry. And in fact, this allows me to make contact with Nadav's talk earlier. These are precisely the operators which are counted by the sure limit of the superconformal index. Yes?
What's the choice of the supercharge? Would that choose the plane, two planes, or just choose the Z-bar?
The supercharge chooses the plane.
So that way
you
have to go with the
plane. Yes. Yes. Of course, yeah, that's how I could have said it. You choose a supercharge that defines the cohomology to live on the plane.
Outside
the plane, there's no cohomology. Now, away from the origin, you need to do something a little bit intricate, which I don't have time to discuss, but it's easy to understand what needs to be done. You have to lock, you have to consider position-dependent combinations of operators, where you lock the position dependence with where they sit in this SU2R multiple. And that will make them live in this cohomology. So I want to describe some rough features of this correspondence. So what we have discovered is that any four-dimensional n equal to superconformal feature is a subset which is isomorphic to a vertex operator algebra, to two-dimensional chiral algebra. The first indication that there is something very nice about this correspondence is that although by construction I only have SL2 symmetry acting on Z, in fact this always gets enhanced to Virasoro. And the way it happens is the 4D theory has a stress tensor. By supersymmetry, the stress tensor lives in a multiplet that contains the art symmetry current. And the art symmetry current gives rise to an operator in the chiral algebra which behaves just like the 2D stress tensor, with a central charge which is minus 12 times the C anomaly coefficient of the 4D theory. Similarly, if the theory happens to have a flavored symmetry, then by Noether theorem, there will be a Noether current, and supersymmetry will put the Noether current to a multiplet whose lowest component is a so-called mom and map operator, which is SU2 R triplet operators of the well, that's before a question, sir. What? I have 25 minutes. the global flavored symmetry will become an affine symmetry with a Kac-Moody current whose level will be minus 1/2 the 4D level. Generators of the four-dimensional Higgs branch become generators of the chiral algebra, and then there's some very nice piece of mathematical physics. I added some new results here because many of you have seen this before, so they may be bored. If you haven't seen the story before, perhaps this is a bit of an overkill. But it turns out that Higgs branch relations, which are geometry of the Higgs branch, if I describe as a variety, are encoded algebraically in the fact that the chiral algebra will have null states. Now, there's an interesting question here. Given the chiral algebra, if I don't know where it comes from, can I recover the geometry of the Higgs branch? And we have a conjecture for this, which is quite non-trivial. First of all, you want to mod out by derivative operators, operators that contain a holomorphic derivative. But that's not quite enough. You further need to mod out by operators which should be nilpotent. For example, I told you the stress tensor operator of the chiral algebra is always generically there, but it corresponds morally speaking, to the four distress sense. So that's not a piece of the Higgs branch. It turns out that in all examples we have looked at, the stress tensor obeys null relations such that L minus 2 squared or L minus 2 to some power is a derivative of T. And so when you mod out by derivatives and by nilpotents, it disappears. And so, in fact, interestingly enough, an algebraic geometer in Japan, Arakawa, had defined this notion before. It's the so-called associative variety of the chiral algebra. And so we have a sharp conjecture. It's great when names are right to be used. The Higgs branch is the associative variety of the chiral algebra. But we have a richer structure, because although the Higgs branch is obtained by modding out by nilpotents, a priori we don't need to. And what we would then get is an unreduced scheme, if I may. And so it's a nice geometric structure. Now, it also the existence of these nilpotents also imply that the character of the chiral algebra, which is the same as the Schur index that Nadav was computing earlier for you, must obey a modular differential equation, because these nilpotents, when looked at on the torus, imply a differential equation which is modularly covariant for the character. And so this has been checked in many cases. For example, the case that that Nadal had this morning, for n equals to 4 for K2 by C2, his character will obey a certain twisted modular differential equation. You have to twist it because you also have half integer powers. And there's an interesting story there. In n equal to 4 super Young Mills, in n equal to 4 super Young Mills, there is an additional fact that generically in n equal to 2 theory, we give a chiral algebra with no supersymmetry whatsoever. In n equal to 4, some supercharges will, in fact, commute with the supercharge that used to go to pass to the cohomology, and so you actually get leftover supersymmetry. So in the case of n equal to 4, we get group SU2, you just get the small n equal to 4 superconformal algebra, the very specific value of the central charge. The central charge is universally given by minus 12 times the C anomaly. So the C anomaly is n square over 4. N square minus 1 over 4 is the rank of the gauge group over 4. And so it's n square minus 1 over 4 times minus 12. It's minus 3 times n square minus 1. Negative. It's very important that the central charges are negative, because this... the representation theory is a lot more intricate. You got a lot more null states, and those are necessary to reproduce the geometry of the Higgs branch.
And in the case of n equals 4 Young Mills, sorry to be so ignorant, but the Higgs branch would be R4 to the n mod SN?
Right.
And how does your mod out by derivative mod out by nilpotents reproduce that?
It's a complicated calculation. Okay. In fact, right. So, some examples. In the case super QCD that Zohar was citing this morning, gives the SO8 affine cosmodic algebra level minus 2. The A6 superconformal theory gives the A6 cosmodic algebra at level minus 3. As I was saying, n equal to 4 super Young Mills gives the super W algebra, which is additional primaries of these dimensions, etc. And then you even get Virasoro minimal model. So Argyris-Douglas theories give you some non-unitary minimal models. Now, this whole set of Argyris-Douglas theory has trivial Higgs branch. So the simplest example is the simplest Argyris-Douglas theory, which has no Higgs branch. It's the so-called H0 theory. That corresponds to the Li-Yang model. The Li-Yang model famously has a null state at level 4, which has L minus 2 squared is proportional to L minus 4. And it is that relation that tells you that the Higgs branch is empty, because I have to mod out by nulls.
Sorry, is the conjecture that the vacuum character of your algebra is the full operator spectrum of the Yang-Mills theory that preserves the supersymmetry?
Yes.
That
well, that's not a conjecture. That's a fact, because it follows from these very broad kinematic facts of just taking this cohomology of the supercharge. Now, whether in specific case we have correctly identified the chiral algebra it's a different store.
And you said in the morning that you checked that the indices.
Yes. So now the analytic power that this scalar algebra gives you allows to compute analytically certain OP coefficients and reinterpret them in four dimensions. And now imposing 4D unitarity, not 2D unitarity, because the 2D theory is not unitary, but imposing 4D unitarity with the analytic power that the chiral algebra allows me, I get to derive novel unitarity constraints on central charges, on the central charge C and K of the theory as a function of this group theoretic number, the dimension of the flavored symmetry and the dual constant number of the flavored symmetry. Yes.
How do you see that difference in your chiral algebra?
Okay, so that's a story that I didn't explain at all. But we have a universal prescription to go from the chiral algebra describes a free theory, or more generally, the chiral algebra describes some interacting blob of things which you weakly gauge. There is a way to follow that transition. From the chiral algebra of the theory where the gauge coupling is strictly zero, you just pose a Gauss law constraint, to the chiral algebra of the theory where the coupling is infinitesimal. And that's a certain cohomological prescription that I would be happy to tell you about. Yeah, so in these examples where I have an affine symmetry, I have a Sugawara construction. And in fact, the second bound here in red is precisely the statement that the Sugawara, if this is saturated, it's telling me that the Sugawara stress tensor, that the stress tensor is a Sugawara stress tensor. But it need not be the case. There could be additional piece on the stress tensor. Now, I'm giving you, for example, so this is the case of SU2, for example. So unfortunately, the colors are not very visible. But the blue bound excludes this region, and the red bound excludes this region. And so this region is allowed. Here I've plotted some known models, which thankfully all lie in the allowed region. And the most interesting model of all is this blue dot here, which is sort of the minimum value of the central charge allowed by the bounds. And that is the simplest Argyris-Douglas theory. Sorry, the next to simplest, the one that that has flavored symmetry, yes, you do. So, in fact, you can classify the symmetry groups that can saturate both bounds. And you get this rather amazing list of Lie algebras, and with these specific values of central charges and levels. And in fact, we of course knew SU2, SU3, SO8, E6, E7, E8. Those are the algebra that arise in F theory. If you take a D3 brain profiling F theory singularity, that's how these theories are realized, and these theories precisely saturate the bounds. So the F theories, the theory that arises from F theory in that way, saturate the bounds. But there are novel objects, F4 and G2. And in fact, to tell you the complete truth, there is also something called E7 plus a half. So this series of algebras had already appeared in the mathematical literature to our amazement. It's called the Deligne exceptional series. It has very magical properties. Of Deligne. So okay, the motivation, as always, the motivations, you know, what mathematicians is always a mystery, right? But apparently, for this very special set of Lie algebras, you can derive uniform dimension formulas for representations. Well, E7 over half is a non-simple algebra that is a certain extension of E7. It is a Lie algebra, it's non-simple. But you know what's simple. So the hunt is open for physical realizations of these other cases, but I don't know if you are motivated by this exceptional mathematics. But the more physical point is that The Higgs branch of this theory has a very simple uniform description. As the minimal nilpotent orbit defined by the so-called Joseph relation that tells you that in the product of two moment maps, you have to set to zero all representations which are different from the representation that is the one is linking labeled twice, the one of the adjoint. And these theories obey a second order modular equation. In fact, if you go back to the classification of characters by Mookie, Sen, et al., back in the 80s, they had a story where of theories that obeyed second-order modular equation. It's the same set of algebras at level one. And now we find that there is a second solution to the modular equation that, of course, couldn't care less about because there are non-unitary theories, where the same algebras appear at negative level and have this physical interpretation. Sorry, the level is not minus one, it's given by these values here, if you multiply by minus a half. The new theories, F4 and G2, I would hope so, but F theory people swear that they cannot get them. But Okay, so there is a similar story in six dimension that I should probably skip entirely.
Is there similar story in five then?
No. And instead flash some results about the numerical boost of supersymmetric theory. So here we have now obtained this infinite amount of protected information given the chiral algebra. We still have to do the hard work of finding non-protected information which we can do numerically. A natural set of models that you want to consider the maximally supersymmetric theories in 3, 4, and 6 dimensions, and those have the nice feature that the stress tensor multiplet sits in a 1/2 BPS multiplet. So, in fact, you can analyze them sort of together, and you find this universal four-point function of stress tensor multiplet, which is just parameterized by the central charge. And so, in these maximally supersymmetric theories, now you have a numerical bootstrap sum rule, which is very similar to the previous one that I had in the generic case, except that now, using the power of the chiral algebra, rather than just having the identity piece, I can compute analytically this infinite amount of sum of shortened representation, which is this red part, parameterized by the central charge. And so let me just flash you some results here. I will be extremely brief. We have done this, and in fact, we have a new paper coming out soon. For n equal 4 super young Mills, what are the highlights of what we find? I think two main messages. First of all, so we have this exclusion curve. So this is the limiting curve. As we improve the precision, the limiting curve goes down, as you would expect. This is an upper bound on the protected of the first unprotected scalar in 220 primes. So that would be something a weak coupling you identify with the Konishi operator. And you have a rigorous bound that tells you, for example, for the value of the central charge that would correspond to gauge group SU2, the Konishi operator can never exceed dimension, in fact, with our latest result, something like 2.95. It's a rigorous upper bound on the dimension of the Konishi operator.
This is the SU2.
For gauge group SU2, for any value of the coupling. For large central charge, we find that the bounds are precisely saturated by supergravity. Of course, it's not surprising that supergravity obeys the bound, because what's surprising, it saturates them. And it saturates them even including one over n square corrections. With great accuracy, the anomalous dimension that I computed as a graduate student with Freeman et al. Are reproduced by the numerical bootstrap bounds. The generic picture for fixed n of how the conformal manifold n equals to 4 would embed into some sort of simultaneous bound for spin 0 and spin 2. So if you do spin 0 and spin 2 simultaneously, you find that the gray region is excluded, and the white region is allowed. So you find this rather sharp feature that it could have been a complicated surface, but you know, it's a rectangular region. And our conjecture is that this corner point, the value of delta 0 and delta 2 that correspond to this corner, is realized at either the Z2 or Z3 point, symmetric point of the conformal manifold. And of course, free field theory is here. So that's a conjecture for which we have some limited evidence, first of all, based on the geometry of the conformal manifold, because this picture suggests that the dimensions here are simultaneously extremized for delta 0, delta 2, and in fact also delta 4 and higher. And that's only naturally happening at either one of the symmetric points. And then also with Ashok, we did some Padé-Resam perturbation theory and found that with relatively good accuracy, that's what perturbation theory was predicting. Now, in the 2,0 theory, yes, we find a sort of very different sort of result. There we find that we have strong evidence, numerical evidence, that the A1 theory, the theory that would correspond to two M5 brains, is unique. Or let me rephrase. I can put a lower bound on the central charge of the theory, and I can in fact prove so lambda is our numerical cutoff. So for each value of the numerical cutoff, I can put a rigorous upper bound, a lower bound than the central charge of the theory. And in fact, you see there is a beautiful extrapolation for large value of the cutoff that inevitably is converging to 25, the best linear fit you've ever seen. And this is in fact telling us that the minimal allowed value of the central charge, if we had infinite numerical precision, would be 25, which is precisely the value of the A1 theory. But that actually means that, remember, I'm saturating a bound, and so I have nowhere to go. If I fix the value of the central charge to be 25, the Boussard equations have a unique solution. The spectrum of the theory is uniquely fixed, at least for the operators zero p coefficient enter this particular four-point function. Unfortunately, it's all numerical. We wish we could prove this analytically, but I find this a striking result. So the mysterious 2,0 theory is determined completely, at least at the level of this of the information enters in this correlator by the Boussard equations. Yes, so for example, sure, operators with more complicated value of the Art symmetry or other quantum numbers, etc. So you have to iterate to get the complete set of operators.
In the N equals 4 case, you put in the value of the central charge to specify it.
So in the N equals 4 case, I went a bit fast. I could play a similar game there, and then there I can actually prove analytically that for an interacting CFT, the central charge has to be greater or equal than one of the SU2 theory. Here I have a similar result for 2,0, which is.
But when you go to the result for the Konishi operator, you have to put it in somehow, and you did that through the central charge.
Yes. Okay, so I'm out of time, but let me mention this cute result of our friends. So there is a funny feature for n equal 1 theories in 4 dimensions that suggests the existence of a 4-dimensional n equal 1 minimal model, namely a theory with a single scalar operator, a chiral operator which should be nilpotent. A little bit more evidence for this can be obtained by continuing across dimension and showing that the same type of kink corresponds to the n equal to 2 3D Ising model, where of course that's the case because the superpotential is phi cube, and also to the corresponding n equal to 2 minimal model in 2 dimensions. So there seems to be a series of theories that continue all the way to 4 dimension, where phi square is 0, and they have a very small value of the central charge for an interacting theory. Okay, so let me try to conclude with some questions. This is all too good to be true. Why is this working? What data we need to corner theories and really be able to solve them by this method, still a bit unclear. At some intuitive level, clearly the reason that this is working is that because the operators of high dimension are decoupling very fast, can this be made into a rigorous framework where you have some sort of effective CFT framework with a precise control of errors. And perhaps if you make this precise, then you have achieved also a mathematically precise formulation, a list of conformal field theories, and if you're optimistic, of general quantum field theory in higher dimensions. So the idea is not, you don't know what to start with Lagrange, and that's sick. Start with the general operator, with this algebraic approach. Perhaps that's something that can, that's amenable to mathematical control. Some structural questions. Let me mention a few of our favorite questions. Most CFTs do not admit spontaneous breaking of conformal invariants. The 3D Ising model, you cannot turn on a VEV. In any force permits, you can. When can you not? Well, presumably, that's a conjecture. In order to be able to turn on a VEV, you need supersymmetry. Yes.
And on what is this based?
Sorry?
On what is this based?
Absence of counterexamples. And the fact that this is a highly non-generic thing, right?
Maybe only just one.
Yes, but you know, it's a very non-generic thing to be able to turn on a VEV. It's
flat potential.
So if you could find an example, you would also have solved the cosmological constant problem.
Well, there are examples
of course, there are examples at infinite length. So yes, so certain fairly obvious assumptions go into the making this conjecture. Similarly, for manifolds of couplings, continuous lines other than fixed isolated points. Again, with the exception of free fields, these are only known to exist for supersymmetric theories, possibly for related reasons. Can one prove this? Is there a framework, obviously using more analytic tools than the one that have been used so far, where this conjecture will be proven? We want to incorporate defects and think about modularity. There's a question that actually added during Zohar's talk, but there's another question that is recurrent in our community. So, well, you sort of take it for granted when you do n equal to 2 super conformal field theories that chiral operators form a freely generated ring. But there's no theorem that should be the case. I mean, it's obviously the case in a Lagrangian theory, but the generic n equal to 2 super conformal field theory, we don't know that to be the case, and it's the kind of thing that you like to prove with the bootstrap. In fact, my former students got a sort of smaller, quicker result. You can prove using this numerical method that there cannot be any nilpotent operators, because you can put a lower bound on the OP coefficient And I did not talk about holography. That's a very interesting set of questions, and clearly there is an enormous amount of things to do. Clearly we're going to finally solve this problem with the conformal window of QCD. That's going to take a few years, but we'll get there. This is the only game in town for theory such as 2,0 theory, and we would like to turn this into a systematic machinery to solve them. And on the more mathematical physics developments, it's very nice that there is an intersection of nice structure, mathematical physics, with this more sort of algebraic viewpoint about quantum field theory, and what else can be done along those lines. Thank you. I did not. In practice, there is a slight modification of these algorithms that allow you to put lower bounds on OP coefficients. And then, yes, we definitely have results along those lines. In fact, one of those, I was sort of quickly mentioning here, we can exclude the fact that n equal to chiral operators cannot be nilpotent. And well, this plot is sort of along those lines. So what happens here is that you find this funny fissure, this funny kink here, and this kink coincides precisely with the point where the lower bound on the OP coefficient of the Tucherel operator is going to zero, which is actually telling you that presumably this point corresponds to the theory where phi squared is zero. Yes. Yes. So those, as far as I can tell, don't have not much to do with this theory. So the drag of the central charge is defined is way too high.
But the dimensions are very close, and they have phi squared equal zero.
They have phi squared equal zero. The dimensions are very far. So the dimension here is 1.43, but with small errors. They have 1.5. But this is a sufficient, this has become a sufficiently precise game that 1.43 is not 1.5. Well, there. But the more serious mismatch is in the central charge. So their central charge is like three times larger.
A year ago, we didn't know any of them. So are you saying that there are tons of them? It's very unlikely that
there's something is 1.43 and another is 1.5. Well, I mean, who knows? I mean, presumably these theories have other. I mean, this is a very rough tool. Like, I'm only looking at this particular correlator. Perhaps there are other chiral operators in the theory that, so the theory is not really, this particular theory is already minimal, or their particular theory is already minimal.
There's a real reason for concern. If you assume that their theory is really exists, and you don't have two theories, then you assume that the cost is not an indication for a theory. This would be a rather dramatic conclusion. Alternatively, there are tons of theories, and this allowed region is populated with a lot of them.
That would be my favorite option. I mean, we should embrace the diversity. So, yes.
Was you confused about the 2.0 stuff? Is there a relation between the C equals 25, which you seem to write the C equals 25 from Euler theory, which is.
Yeah, there is a mysterious relation that I can't. Really explain, which will in fact persist for the higher rank theories. So the value of the central charge of the C anomaly of the 2.0 theory of type AN indeed coincides with the critical values of the appropriate W theories. Right, so this is in some sense has appeared before in the sense that if you look at the AGT relation for B equal to 1, you get precisely these critical values. And I mean, the fact that these values were the minimal ones, of course, has been known for a long time. The C anomalies had been known before. What we add to the story is that we have indication that this is the absolute minimal possible value for C for the interacting theory. Yes.
So, this is one plus one dimensions.
There are
there any inconsistent theories where you can't see the inconsistent theory, but you consider it
absolutely. Absolutely.
So it's surprising that seems to apply almost no role.
No, he uses in 1 plus 1.
Yeah, in 1 plus 1.
Absolutely. So in 1 plus 1, you could, in fact, there's a whole story that I haven't even had time to mention about using these techniques for two-dimensional non-rational CFTs. And there, of course, you could very much impose both sets of constraints. The two types of constraints are this plots are more different regions of parameter space because these sort of numerical results are about the low-lying spectrum, and whereas the modular results are more about the asymptotic growth of states.
Yeah, that's right. Those both
are important.
You might find fake theories.
Right. In higher dimensions, we haven't yet found a sharp incarnation of these modular constraints.
Yeah.
So, I don't know what.
I don't know.
Well, no, then I need to wish David happy birthday, which I didn't get, I didn't get to at the beginning, and I wanted to say we never really were in the same institution working together, but I've met David many times over the year, and he always knows what I'm doing. He always is extremely enthusiastic, extremely supportive, and, you know, I was thinking about it. Am I special? And then I thought, obviously not. So obviously he must be doing this with all or with most younger people, and thank you very much.